Morning to all of you. We are so glad to see you all here. I wish today to be a very special and meaningful day for all of us. Our hearty welcome to respected principals and distinguished guests, special invitees and attendees of the workshop on machine learning with Python. I am taking this opportunity to introduce our department to all of you. The Department of Computer Science and Engineering at the B.V. Raju Institute of Technology was started in the year 1997. The department offers UG B.Tech program with an intake of 300 students and the PG M.Tech program both in Computer Science and Engineering and Software Engineering. Department is accredited by both NBA and NAC. From this academic year 2020-2021, we are approved to conduct three more specialized B.Tech courses, namely intelligence, machine learning. All these courses have been approved with an intake of 180 students. We have signed the MOU with several industries and training partners. Also, we have signed MOU with universities from US, Canada, and UK for the research collaborations, student certification, and promoting integrated PG courses. Our students are additionally encouraged to participate in multidisciplinary projects and a special focus is given to assistive technology laboratory exercises. Some of the focus trainings which we have been offering for the placements are Advanced Programming Techniques, Telangana Academy for Skills and Knowledge, Campus Recruitment Training, PEGA Certification Courses, Robotic Process Automation, NASCOM and CoCube Training, Online Certifications with NPTEL and Coursera, National Level Hackathon Online and Offline Coding Contest Training, British English Certification, a Special Center for Graduate Study in Abroad Center to empower and bolster students to take up higher studies abroad. We strive diligently to improve the overall knowledge, technical skill, aptitude and moral conduct of our students. To cater to this requirement, we have designed and conducted residential workshops at Vishnu Educational Development and Innovation Center to meet the qualities and requirements of the millennial students. Among all the workshops, the following are exceptionally valued and highly appreciated by the students. Career aspirations in science and technology, intellectual learning in engineering application, aspire for career excellence, self-management skills. Now, I'm extremely extending my heartiest welcome to our beloved principal, Dr. Lakshmi Prasad Garu. I'm taking this privileged moment to introduce his profile briefly. He is a distinguished professor of civil engineering. He has immense educational experience as professor at reputed institutions. He obtained his PhD in water resource engineering from IIT Bombay in the year 2000. M.Tech in Hydraulic Engineering from IIT Bombay in the year 1985. B.Tech in Civil Engineering from JNTU Anantapur College of Engineering in the year 1983. He has successfully steered two sponsored research and development projects worth 3.8 crores sponsored by DST, MHRD, Government of India in 2014-18. As a principal investigator. He has published several papers in international referee journals and international and national conferences. He could spread the fragrance of motivation and inspiration in every moment of his speech, and he is a very influential leader. With these few words of introduction, I request our principal sir to deliver the inaugural address and bless the occasion.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Lakshmi Garu, for introducing me. Really, I'm delighted to see how the CSC department has come out with this 1 week faculty development program with the resources in the department itself. I'm very happy to note that the head of the department of CSC, Dr. Madhubabu, how he has articulated this entire program with the help of Mr. Shamalra and Mr. Shabir, basically. And then the best resource persons of the department, Dr. Suresh Dara, Dr. Lakshmi, Dr. Chiranjeevi, and Dr. Purnachand, so that they will really emulate the entire participants with their knowledge on machine learning with Python, that too with hands-on experience. And I'm really Mr. M.B. Venu, the senior software engineer, Microsoft Corporation, Hyderabad, for really participating into today's program as chief guest. And I'm really, really thankful for their gesture in really coming back to the institution, not physically, but at least virtually, and then spending some time with the faculty and with the participants from different institutions. I also thank Sri V. Rajshekhar Garu, the senior software engineer of Microsoft Corporation, Hyderabad, basically, who is very specialized in artificial intelligence and neural networks. And both these experts who are working right now in the machine learning and artificial intelligence areas, and their presence here definitely boost what you call it as the motivation levels of all the participants participating in this program. And at this juncture, when we all know that we cannot be connected at one place, connecting through online, thereby sharing the experiences is really a wonderful moment. And probably COVID-19 has provided, on one side, there are innumerable challenges how to come out of this situation, but at the same time, that challenge has forced or provided an opportunity for learning more and more, for self-learning, for peer learning, for expert learning. So it has provided an opportunity for all the people to learn themselves and then to upgrade themselves. And thereby, when we face the students tomorrow, or when we go to the students tomorrow, definitely we are much more equipped, much more what you call it as energized, or much more what you call it as information providers, so that our journey, which is going to be, I'm sure that this journey of whatever online journey that we are doing, it's not going to be a temporary phenomena. I'm sure at least coming 1 year, it's going to be a regular phenomena for all of us. And I'm very happy that a very good number of participants are participating in this program. And I'm sure that after this 1 week program, all of you will take away so much of the outcomes from this program. And we are also working on only what exactly the outcome of the each day's program. To that extent, the department has meticulously planned the thing, and we assure you and ensure on our side that we give the best to you. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. I'm sure that this is going to be a grand success with all your participation, with all your active participation. I once again thank our guests of today, our distinguished alumnus, Mr. Venu, and Sri V. Rajshekhar Garu for their participation. And I really congratulate the resource persons for their valuable, what you call it as the time, and sharing their knowledge, basically. Thank you. Thank you all. And I welcome you all to basically virtually to BVR at INASPUR program, basically. Thank you.
Now I request our guests of today's session, Mr. M.V. Venu and Mr. V. Rajshekhar, senior software engineers, Microsoft Corporation, having 15 years of experience in the field of machine learning. Now I would like to invite Mr. M.V. Venu to share his real-time experience and industrial scenarios.
Thank you, ma'am. Can you all hear me?
Yes, sir.
Sure. I'll just get started with a brief introduction to myself. As Principal has rightly called out with warm words, I am an alumnus of B.V. Raju Institute of Technology. and then I got campus recruited into Wipro Technologies, and then I worked briefly with Computer Sciences Corp. And since the past 8 years, I'm working with Microsoft in the products division of enterprise commerce. I'll just share my screen and I'll give a brief introduction of machine learning. This is a PowerPoint slide which I created for internal purposes within Microsoft. I'll just share the same presentation with you. And while I'm doing that, I will skim through a few slides and I will draw your attention to a few slides which actually are very relevant to the audience here. Ma'am, this is going to stop your screen sharing and it's going to start sharing my screen.
Yes, sir, please, you can proceed.
Okay. Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir. I think we can put it in the display, means screen display mode, slide transition mode. Slideshow mode we can put. That is the only thing. Other than that, it is visible. Yeah, thank you.
Okay. There are a few slides which may not be relevant to this audience here, and in those cases I'm just going to skip through those slides. So we've been talking about AI and ML and deep learning. So these are the buzzwords right now, and they have become relevant all of a sudden, and we need to understand what AI is, what ML is, and what's the difference between both of them, and where does deep learning fit into all of this. So artificial intelligence is the subset, is the bigger circle which encompasses machine learning and deep learning. So artificial intelligence is basically, you can see the definition on the screen. I'm not going to read through the definition, but it is something which can augment human capabilities to perform a specific task. So we as humans are limited in certain areas, and we're going to depend on our machines to augment our capabilities. Then that is artificial intelligence. Coming to machine learning, it is basically a subset of artificial intelligence. Now machine learning basically implements the capabilities which we as humans want to be augmented. So right now we are so used to writing a set of instructions, calling it a program and saying we want to execute it. But machine learning will augment your capability to write a program. And then you have deep learning. In deep learning, when I give you a set of data, for example, if I give you the historical data of how the stock market has been performing over the years, it is difficult for you to predict what might happen in the next cycle of the stock market. Will you be able to predict what might happen tomorrow? The reason our prediction may not match what's going to happen in the stock market tomorrow is there are certain features or there are certain traits of the data which is provided to us which we are not able to identify. Our human capability is limited in the identification of the traits or the underlying features of the data, and which is why we depend on the machine to extract those features which we have missed out while making the prediction and help us get a more accurate prediction about what might happen in the stock market or what might happen tomorrow in terms of the weather forecast and so many other things. So that's where deep learning fits into AI and machine learning. Now, in machine learning, you have intelligent algorithms, okay, which are part of the course. I have gone through the course content, and Dr. Poonachan was kind enough to share the course content with me, and I see that you're going to do a lot more in terms of machine learning in this course. Deep learning, on the other hand, involves the application of neural networks. So if we understand what machine learning is, we will appreciate the fact that machine learning takes us only so far in our journey towards extracting the features from data. But somewhere down the line, we are going to identify that, you know what, machine learning can do only so much for me. I need something more to find the hidden traits of data, and that's where deep learning is going to come in. So having said that, I'll just quickly move to, I'll skip a few slides for everyone's benefit here. So this is about the KNN algorithm, which you're going to learn through the course, but I want to draw your focus to this slide. So what are we used to doing traditionally? Say, for example, let's take a very small program like generating a Fibonacci series. You're going to give the data. You're going to generate one number after the other. That is the data here. And then you're going to write a program to generate the Fibonacci series and feed it to the system. The system will just generate the Fibonacci series and give the output to you. This is our traditional way of writing a program. This is what we are used to completely. Now, when it comes to machine learning? In machine learning, if you see the boxes here, the program and the output from traditional learning have been interchanged in the figure below. You see, I'm giving the data to the system, I'm giving the output to the system, and the system is giving the program for me. So I want to draw your attention to the second part of this video. So you're going to give data and you're going to give output to the system, and the system actually generates the program. I'll explain this with another example. Say for if I ask you to write a program to extract my face out of a passport size photograph which I give you, you'll write a program which traces the contours of my face. And it'll say, you know what, Venu, this is your face here. But if I give you another passport size photograph, or if I give you another photograph with me holidaying, and I ask you to extract my face out of that photograph, you'll have to write another program. I give you another picture, you'll write another program. I give you another picture, you'll write another program. You keep repeating this because you cannot write a generic program which extracts my face out of the picture, out of the different pictures which I'm giving you. This is where machine learning actually steps in. Machine learning says, you know what, relax. I will do the hard work for you. You just give me the data. The data is nothing but the pictures. My different pictures of me. And it says, okay, fine. Venu, just tell me, are you in this picture or not? And I say, yeah, I'm in this picture. I am in this picture. I'm not in this picture. And then I just feed it to the system. I give it to an algorithm. And the algorithm gives a program which identifies my face in every other picture. The algorithm, the algorithms in the market currently are so powerful that they can even identify my face through a video input at a traffic signal. So that's the place where we are at currently. Now, let me take a step back. How did AI and ML, you know, just pop out of nowhere and become the buzzwords in the past 5 years and say, you know what, this is AI and ML is the future of the industry. How is it going to impact jobs and everything? Before AI and ML, we used to have something called as rule-based systems. The rule-based systems are basically called as expert systems, and they are very, very intelligent. But they are not artificially intelligent. They work on a set of rules. They cannot think by themselves. So these are called as expert systems. Most of the programs which we write today are expert systems. But computers were not just designed for expert systems. computers were actually designed to perform computations at a much higher rate, which when compared to human beings. So that was the basic reason behind which computers were designed. So machine learning, with the increase in technology and with the advancement of technology, machine learning ensured that it found its rightful place in our ecosystems. Now, from 2013 or 2010, basically, onwards, AI and ML came into prominence because industry stepped in to make more powerful computer chips. For example, NVIDIA started designing powerful graphic cards. Initially, graphic cards was usually synonymous with computer games, because to support high performance computer games, you need to have high performance graphic cards. And that's when NVIDIA thought, you know what, if I am able to perform computations worth millions in a second, then I might actually use this for another purpose, and that is for machine learning. So that's when AI and ML really took off, with the industry stepping in. Then how do you approach AI and ML actually? When you are presented with a problem, how do you identify whether it really becomes a part of, whether that problem can actually be solved with machine learning or not? I think once you go through the content of this course, you'll be in a far, far better position to see if a problem which is presented to you can be solved with machine learning or not. So not every problem can be solved with machine learning. In the same way, not every problem belongs to the machine learning problem category. So it's very important to differentiate what problem can be solved with machine learning and what problem cannot be solved with machine learning. I'll just skim through the rest of the slides and see if there is anything important. Okay, so this slide is a quick example of how artificial intelligence is and machine learning is closer to us than we actually think it is. Artificial intelligence and machine learning were, a part of a niche group earlier, but it's not the case anymore. If you take email classification, most of the emails which you get, advertising emails, usually fall into the spam folder automatically. How does the email server actually understand what is spam and not spam on your behalf? So that classification problem was actually solved using machine learning. And then we also have sentiment analysis. Sentiment analysis using computer vision. Myself and Raj, we had actually done a project in Microsoft using computer vision, which actually predicted the sentiment of a small child going to school. At the end of this slide, I will hand it off to him, and he's going to talk about the implementation. And the next thing, this is a really cool feature which Microsoft actually introduced in Office tools. So I think with the audience,
sir, audio is not up to the mark, sir. Audio.
Oh, can you hear me now?
Yes, yes, exactly.
Oh, I was speaking through the previous slide. Did you listen through? I mean, were you able to hear the previous slide?
Yeah, Vindu, can you also put it in the full presentation mode? Raj here.
Full presentation mode, yeah.
Just last few seconds only, sir. You can continue, sir.
Okay. So the last.
And Venu, Raj here. Can you actually make it a full presentation? Venu, can you hear me?
Okay. I see what's happening, Raj. Yeah, got it. I am sharing the wrong screen actually.
Just okay. Okay.
I think now you should be able to see it in the full presentation mode. Is it? Can you?
Yeah, I mean it's good now.
It's okay. It's good. Okay, cool. I was sharing the wrong screen. So it's a dual monitor. Okay. Anyway,
also let's watch out some of the comments if somebody is unable to hear, right? So
yeah, sure
if possible. Yeah,
also please let me know if you know there are any questions from the audience. I'll be happy to take a few of them. And one last thing is Poonachan sir, can you please do a timer check for me? I don't want to overrun you know today's course.
Sir, please, you can wind up after 5 minutes.
Okay, sure. Yeah, I'll just keep a note of that.
Yeah, please.
So I'll just show the cool feature, inking feature, which is there in Office Tools, which has been implemented using AI. Just give me a second. I will pull the Microsoft Word document here. Okay. So in Microsoft Word, we've actually implemented the inking feature, which is actually an implementation of AI. So when you write something here, when you write the math here, it automatically understands what you're writing and it converts it into a formula. So I just start writing a simple formula like a plus b whole square. So that's my bracket here. It identified this as an angular bracket, but let's see how it autocorrects itself as it moves forward. I write A here, and you see the bracket got autocorrected to C, and then I write plus here, it identified plus correctly. Then I write B, and I close the brace. You see that? So how did the system actually identify that was a formula which I had written? And this is very particular, this is particularly useful when engineering graduates work on their thesis and paper presentations where they have to insert a lot of formula in their work. So this is one of the cool features which AI has, which Microsoft has introduced using AI. So AI, the point I want to drive is AI is actually more closer to us than we think. Raj, you want to share the sentiment analysis?
Yeah, so I don't have a presentation. Hi everyone, okay. Myself Raj. So as Venu was rightly called out, there are a lot of applications for the artificial intelligence and the machine learning, right? So one of them I wanted to cover now is the sentiment analysis. So recently, as part of one of the hackathon programs we have conducted in Microsoft, we found that we built an application called Emotifix. Right, so this is actually, we targeted the schools and colleges mostly, where people, there will be setting up some of the cameras in the colleges and the schools that will continuously capture the videos and the emotions, videos of the students in the class. What that will do is that we have built an engine, a ML engine, where that will identify the faces of the student, and also it will identify the whether he's in a sad mode or happy mode, or it will find the sentiments of that student. So that application, we applied multiple algorithms on it, and then capture the images and then build and then come up with the analysis for each and every student. And we have also implemented a predictive analysis on that, and that will actually tell you that, okay, this student is happy for this many hours in a day, and this student is happy, he's attentive in a class for 10 minutes in after 40 minutes. So we have come up with some of the sentiment analysis like that. So that's one of the application, and we are proposing to the government of India as well. So yeah, that's it, Venu. Okay, sorry, my voice is not clear.
Yes, it's audible.
Yeah, I got some comments saying that it's not clear. Okay, so you got my point, right? So this application will actually find the patterns in your face of the student and then try to come up with the different emotions of the student and give you a brief report of it. That's the beauty of the ML and then artificial intelligence. So the class teacher or a class lecturer can actually talk to them privately if the same sentiment continues for a week, if I'm sad for a week. So this system will present in such a way that this student is actually sad for a week. So it's productively identify the moods of a student, and we can actually talk to them, or maybe we can send a report to a parent saying that they can appear. So hey, there is something wrong with your kid. He's not well since a week. Can you take care of him? So this type of applications can be built with an ML in an AI. That's it. When you can take up.
Yeah, sure, Raj. So I will I'll just present one more industrial application of artificial intelligence. Let me skip through this slide really fast. Okay. So an industrial application, and this is one of the projects which I got an opportunity to work on. So we have antivirus in our systems, right? So antivirus definitions need to be continuously updated. You find a new virus, you update the definition, and your antivirus stays updated and your system is protected. So few folks actually thought that, you know what, can I implement artificial intelligence in antivirus? So they came up, this was a project which was carried out in Germany, I believe. The name of the project was called as Malware. So in Malware, it was basically malware heuristics. That's what it stands for, malware heuristics. And it was basically they built an artificially intelligent anti-spyware system which automatically detected any anomalies. It used to scan the packets which were coming into the system, and it used to automatically detect any anomalies in the behavior of the packets and flag them as antivirus or not. So we get a lot of notifications on our machines, right, saying that possible antivirus file detected and so on. So one of the key implementations was done by Malware, and this Malware was an output of a university which the industry embraced. So I want to tell the audience here that the industry always looks to centers of learning for inspiration. Otherwise, the industry is just a monotonous place which goes on and on and on doing the same repetitive things. Yes, there are innovations in industry, but the industry actually looks for centers of learning and academia for inspirations. And just to conclude, there are implementations of AI and ML in different fields and different industries. For example, in technology, I just showed you the email classification, sentiment analysis, and the inking feature in office tools and antivirus. So these are the implementations in the technology field. In the automobile field, we have autonomous driving coming through. You have heard enough of news about autonomous driving. And then in law enforcement, I think with COVID-19, Hyderabad Traffic Police has implemented a model, an AI model, where it will automatically tell whether social distancing norms are being followed or not. And in the same way, they have a model which helps detect if people are riding without helmets or not. So all of these. Fields and industries are actually embracing AI and ML like never before. So AI and ML have a huge, huge potential and future. Most of AI and ML is still in the labs, even as we talk. It's still in the labs, and there's a lot of research being carried out. And it's a very opportune time that this workshop is being conducted. Because by the time AI and ML comes out of the labs, I'm sure many of us will be in a far better shape to embrace AI and ML. Coming to the last point which I wanted to cover, I'll take a minute more, not more than that. Why should we use Python in machine learning? Python should be used in machine learning because it is open source and it gives a huge, huge array of libraries for you to use. You have a problem, you go consult Python. More often than not, you'll find a library which addresses your solution. So Python exposes Keras, TensorFlow, Scikit-learn. These are all the libraries which you're going to use in the workshop. And then you're going to use NumPy, which is used for scientific computing. Then you're going to use SciPy, which is used for advanced computing. And you're going to use Pandas. Pandas is going to be everywhere. You have data, you have to use Pandas. And then in the same way, you're going to use Pandas for data analysis. Now you want to visualize the analyzed data, you have a library called as Seaborn. There are hundreds and thousands of libraries at your disposal to use in Python. And to conclude, thanks so much for giving me and Raj the opportunity to speak on this forum. And I'm going to end my screen sharing. Ma'am, you can take it back.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Venu and Rajashekhar, for sharing your work experience and real-time use cases and industrial scenarios. It's our indeed pleasure to thank you for accepting our invitation, the short duration, and being with us today. Thank you very much. We request our Bureau HOD, Dr. Madhubabu Garu, who is a dynamic leader in strengthening our department. I welcome our HOD to address the gathering.
Thank you, madam. Good morning to one and all. Special thanks to our chief guests, Mr. Venu and Rajashekhar Garu from Microsoft, for taking the time and joining us. And I extend my warm greetings to one and all. I thank our management and the principal for encouraging us to host this mega event. I am extremely happy to receive awesome response from participants all over the country for this 6 days hands-on FDP. I would like to thank all the participants for showing their interest and participating in the FDP on these trending technologies. I would like to say a few words about the resource persons of this FDP. Dr. D. Lakshmi Madam and M. Chiranjeevi Garu, Suresh Dara Garu, and K. Purnachandra Garu. All these resource persons are certified through NPTEL, Coursera, and NASSCOM. They are consistently excelling their skills and expertise in the domain of machine learning and deep learning. And after the speeches from Mr. Rajashekhar and Venu, I do not have nothing to speak on technologies. So just I want to take this opportunity to thank the people who are behind this program. I want to thank the coordinators of this FDP, Shyamal Rao and Shabbi, for their endless efforts. And Mr. Shyam has put his tireless efforts for the last weekdays in communicating the workshop details with the participants, not only in Telugu states, but also from the remaining parts of the country. If I don't mention one name, this name, it will be a mistake from my side that he is the person who is behind the show and guiding the coordinators in every aspect, in all aspects. He is none other than my brother, Dr. Purnachand, and his association with Dr. Lakshmi Madam made this FDP possible in short duration. I thank all CSC faculty for their cooperation and support all the time. And I hope you not only benefit from these sessions, but also thoroughly enjoy the 6 days of these machine learning sessions. All the best, and I wish you all the success. Thank you. I request Lakshmi Madam to continue these sessions to move forward with this session.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Respected Principal, HOD, and dear faculty members and attendees of this workshop, good morning all of you. I welcome you to this workshop day one. I am Dr. Lakshmi, Associate Professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering at B.V. Raj Institute of Technology. If we start with the definition of data science, it's the culmination of statistical modeling statistical computing and probability, data technology, data research, data consulting, real world application. It is possible to bring a lot of real world application with the data science. Scientific methods are involved. We can visualize the data and we can take decisions for the business movements. So with this introduction, let me start with today's agenda. Today we are going to start with data science and its importance, key elements of data science, introduction to machine learning, artificial intelligence, and machine learning introduction. To start with history of data science, this is what the set syllabus of this workshop. History of data science, if we look at keenly, started 1943. It's not so new at all. That is a message I wanted to communicate. But because of technological revolution and automation and numerous transactions is happening both with the mobile and the online devices for the banking sector and the online bookings, air tickets, travels and business models like a Big Bazaar and Amazon and Flipkart, so many business model paradigm changed. These are all the changes brought data science to become so famous. The very first data science or machine learning model is being proposed by Macalo and Pitt in 1943, and subsequently it started taking lot of growth in it. Exploratory data analysis is what the set syllabus for today's discussion. 1977 itself, exploratory data analysis became famous. But now we are talking, it's a hot cake of the day because of the usage. So far now, the usage of computer itself was very much lesser two decades ago. Recent 1 decade, the technology computer as well as mobile plays vital role in every sphere, including education. We started automating education. We started using a lot of tools and softwares. Similarly, in the industrial scenario, each and every business use cases revolves with the data, plenty of data. Data only guides all the business stakeholders to fix their competitive price, to run their business model and to move forward. That is why data science or importance of data became very vital in these recent days, especially 2020 onwards. It's becoming very much important day by day. After COVID, most of the industry communication, industrial work progress started becoming online. Recent days, especially past 6 months, we can notice the tremendous growth of data within the organization and beyond the organization. These are all the necessity makes us to move forward in learning data science and contributing towards this. Now, data warehouse is a medium to store all the data. That part becomes data lakes, data warehouse, big data, streaming data, that all becomes different domain. But what we are going to look at in this 6 days workshop, we are going to look at offline data analysis, discovery of data inside. Given the data, how we can derive insights, what are the mathematical model, statistical models and probability model we can apply in inferring insights among the data. And what are the data models available, how it classified into different models and what is the mathematical principle behind of each model, at what situation we can use such kind of model, how to understand the data, how to understand the model and how we can integrate the model and the data in order to derive the insights from the data. These are all the insights we are going to look at. Finally, insights are helpful for increasing the business value. That is the ultimate purpose of data science or data analytics, in order to increase the business value or making it to be profitable among all other competitors, or else we can say how we can move it forward with our business strategies and paradigms. That is the main purpose of data science. It's an integration of algorithm, it's an integration with the model with the statistical packages. Ultimately, statistics and the probability, 80% of the time within the data science plays a vital role in doing analysis. Perhaps Mr. Venu touched upon the difference between artificial intelligence, machine learning and deep learning. I don't want to duplicate again. Yeah, coming to start with data analytics, majorly it is classified into supervised learning, unsupervised learning, reinforcement learning. To start with supervised learning, whenever data is given with label, what is the meaning of label? When the data is given, we need to understand the moment the data set is brought to the discussion, you can perhaps understand much better. it has independent variable and dependent variable. For example, in the case of Gmail, if you look at the Gmail homepage, it is categorized into inbox, spam, it is categorized into update, social, and promotions. So these are all the five folder. The moment mail comes or reaches to your inbox, it starts categorizing, identifying where it needs to be pushed, which folder it needs to be pushed. For that, the output, being a user, being a common layman, we come to know these five labels: spam folder, inbox folder, update folder, social folder. These are all the folder name categorized. So then each folder on what attributes, on what triads that it starts classifying that mail is of that category, that needs to be trained. Those data helps for training or predicting the type of the mail is termed as independent variable. Finally, telling that mail is of spam category, that mail is of important and regular mail that goes to inbox, or that mail is important for classified into social and update, then it will be classified as label. It is called dependent variable. That dependency is based on several attributes. The moment we say spam folder, spam always leads with bulk mailing and all the money related and all the miswords or misuses, fishy words or fishy things, whichever is composed into the mail, that are all treated by Google as a spam. The moment any one of that keyword, any one of the attribute happens to see in the composition of mail, immediately it will start classifying into spam mail. Spam folder, the keyword guides. So these are all the keywords guiding to categorize, treat that mail as a spam mail. That is said to be independent variable. Shortly we will be discussing in detail, no need to worry. This spam is said to be a dependent variable or label, I can say perhaps. Suppose the mail is sent to inbox, formal invitation mail of, for example, for the FDP, if at all, we are composing, we are inviting you to join the 6 days workshop at the B.B. Raj Institute of Technology. That seems to be highly official and professional. Or any mail comes from previously communicated people. Anyone you communicate previously, again, if you receive mail from the, such kind of people, immediately, whether it is really spam or not, once if you communicate, that mail directly forwarded to inbox. These are all the attributes helping us in labeling certain mail where need to be classified. So that is termed as label. This label guides for taking the decision making. Labels only helps for decision making. That is called supervised learning. Supervise something is available for learning or taking decision. So underneath, it is majorly classified into three category: classification, regression, optimization. The moment we say classification, whenever the dependent variable is of categorical in nature. For example, this is classic example: spam mail, inbox mail, social mail, update mail. So these are all classical example. There are four labels or four categories. Each and every mail will have set of attributes. Upon those attributes, the decision need to be taken. These attributes will help or guide the machine or the model to take decision among these four categories. So this is called classification. The moment it is used as labels or categorical string data type or categorical data type, even if it is of 1, 2, 3 category, 1, 2, 3, 4 category, even although it looks like a numerical, it is all of categorical or label in nature, so that it is treated as classification model. The moment the dependent variable becomes numerical or continuous variable, for example, predicting the price of the air ticket price fixation, each and every day they are simulating, depending upon the previous history. The same day in the past month, what happened? The same day, past few years, what happened? What was the what demand for that particular flight, for that particular date, for that particular source and destination? So these are all the attributes supplied to that analysis. The moment these attributes are supplied, it will start recommending the price for that day, for that flight, particular flight. So based on the past history, fixing the price for today's flight between 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock from Hyderabad to Bangalore. If we try, then the price of the air ticket goes like this, 3K or 3.5K, something like that. So the moment numerical or continuous value, if we wish to predict, that is termed as regression. The moment we start predicting labels, it is said as classification. Amazon starts classifying all their customers into several categories: prime customers, regular customers, and frequent customers, and rarely visited customers. Depending upon the category of the customer, they will be giving promotional code. By the time the classification is helpful. Unless otherwise they classify their customers, they cannot promote with the same amount of discount for each of the category. Similarly, Uber and Ola, they also will classify their customer based on regular traveler, frequent traveler, or occasional traveler. So these are all the kind of regular, frequent, and occasional traveler. Depending upon their usage of their business, they will be categorizing and giving the promotional code and giving the discounts. By that situation, we will be applying classification algorithm. Any moment we are in the position to predict value, stock market, financial analytics, any moment we are in the position to predict numerical value, something like that, 5.5, anything, numerical value or continuous value, we supposed to use regression. Optimization technique itself supplementary for helping all other algorithms to optimize and take decision model, particle swarm optimization, anti-colony optimization. There are several. It's again another ocean. So optimization technique, these all will comes under supervised learning algorithm. Let us move on to unsupervised learning algorithm. The major category of algorithm are these three. Among these three, we are going one by one. Unsupervised algorithm, clustering, association analytics, dimensionality reduction, recommendation system, feature analysis system, sentiment analysis. These are all the category come into unsupervised learning. Some of the algorithms, some of the categories within the 6 days of workshop, there are resource persons will be addressing. By that time, you will come to know little bit. In couple of hours, I will be starting with the dimensionality reduction. Recommender system, we can look at YouTube has recommendation. Google homepage has recommendation. Depending upon what is the theme of video we are keep on watching. If we start watching a machine learning related video continuously for 1 or 2 hours or 5 to 10 videos, immediately my YouTube page will be filled with the machine learning. The moment if I start listening to Hindi songs, movie songs, immediately what it starts doing is, if I start watching 5 Hindi songs, immediately it will start loading entire my homepage of YouTube, filling with Hindi songs. This is one such example. Day by day we are coming across that is recommender system. If we go to Facebook, what is happening? It will start collecting our data, which institution I studied, where I worked, which are all the cities I'm living. Then depending upon that, it starts recommending. These are all the people, friend of your already available network, or this is the person studied at Madras University along with you. Something like that start recommending. So this is the recommender system. And if you look at Netflix, Amazon, these are Amazon Prime, these are all the movie recommendations start recommending. The moment we watch Telugu movie, then immediately it starts recommending latest Telugu movies. That is called recommender system. Then feature analysis. Feature analysis is for business value taking. Sentiment analysis, even that industrialist, they touched upon today's guest. Next, reinforcement learning. This is useful for gamification and robot and drones and all the industrial automation and application. Reinforcement learning is useful. In this workshop, we are not touching upon reinforcement learning, but I'm giving just a small introduction. With that, let us move on to the next slide. So these are all the some of the few cases. Facebook, without data analysis, Facebook cannot survive even for a minute. Depending upon recommender system or analysis or prediction, classification, these are all the algorithm, all together it starts applying. So big data, streaming the data, in-stream analysis, all those concepts, whatever we study in the domain of big data and data analysis, Facebook extensively uses, similarly Amazon, Uber. I'll be discussing about Uber use cases a little bit detail. Bank of America, not only Bank of America, all the banking sector, banking services, they started understanding loyal customers, they started calculating CIBIL score. Depending upon the CIBIL score, they will be granting the loan amount. Although I apply for 45 lakhs or 55 lakhs, bank will not sanction 55 lakhs or what I am requesting the bank. Definitely, they will be analyzing with a lot of my past history. CIBIL score, they will be looking into my age and what is my salary income and who is my dependent or whom I am dependent and what is the background of my dependent. All together, they will be taking decision. What is my qualification? Is there any progress in my working sector? Whether I'm every bank will be categorizing all the customers into industrial customers and academicians and business and farmer agriculture background. They'll be having a lot of pinpoint for taking decision and sanctioning the loan amount. All Airbnb services, even what else, flight services, all the traveling systems, even railway systems and railway traveling ticket booking and bus ticket booking, each and every private sector, they started running their own apps for ticket booking and notification and tracking GPRS all together. Spotify is like Amazon Prime, it's for music recommendation. So everywhere data science plays a role. Without that, these are all the business cannot even move even a single minute. Healthcare, predominantly data analytics part is used. Anybody is admitted, especially in the ICU, there are several monitoring gadgets will be going on. Then all those data together, they will be taking decision. What is the position of that particular moment and how they need to treat further. So multiple readings, multiple signals started generating from that particular moment or several devices. Human cannot able to interpret all those decision making. By the time they are intervening, this machine learning algorithm, finance matter, fraud detection, all the banking sector starts doing fraud detection. And manufacturing anomaly detection and retail inventory optimization, insurance and the client risk scoring. N number of use cases these days revolves around. There is no particular use case. Even power system management, people started using. The entire electrical department now relies on big data analysis and the entire electrical department relies on data analytics for monitoring and repairing and maintenance and reading the data and understanding what's happening in the power stations. Multiple power stations. Now, let me start with Uber case study. Uber case study, very first, how to pull their cars in a particular pin location. Every Uber may have, perhaps if I take the use case of Hyderabad, definitely I can assure 1 lakh Uber cars are operating. Each and every day, not now because of COVID situation, the regular time. More than 1 lakh Uber car or Ola car started revolving across the city. Then how they need to channelize for each and every pin location. Then they will move on to the past history of 1 week, 1 month, ultimately 1 year. How many requests and how many business requests had come in that particular pin location? Business request or travel request from the customer or the passenger. How many requests had come and how many successful travel happened? People may put a request, then they may not travel. So all together they will consider. Depending upon that demand, they will be forecasting and they will be taking decision and they will pull out the car in that particular location, including the time, not all the time. Time is a predominant role player in the data analytics field for the Uber. 5 to 6 o'clock in the evening would be different from night 10 to 11 o'clock. It would be different from mid-afternoon 1 to 2 o'clock. So time plays a vital role in pulling the car also, along with the trend of past 1 week, past 1 month and past 1 year. So from that moment onwards, this data analysis or something, machine learning supports them. Subsequently, the moment a passenger books the ticket or gives a request, immediately it needs to connect with, it needs to identify all the surrounding availability of the cars, it needs to identify. The moment it identifies, then by that time it needs to pull the data. How many cars are within the radius of 2 to 3 kilometers, it will, or sometime it may extend up to 5 kilometers also. We may not take decision anything, but depending upon the availability, depending upon the radius or circumference, it will start taking the decision. The moment the decision is taken, then it will assign the passenger and the car. It will pair the car and the passenger. Then subsequently, what it does, the moment again the passenger denies that particular offer, then it will be treated as a backlog or something like a bad treatment. Only 3 options they will give for denial in every month. That is also considered as your even passenger loyalty. Similarly, if the driver denies the request, there will be different mode of treating that particular business model. Denial is also one of the key parameters, count of every denial. So once there is no denial, yes, it is successful, then fixing the price depending upon the demand or that particular time and the particular moment, what is the demand, it will start raising. Simply, any one of you start on clicking and searching for the car standing in particular pin location, that search also will increase the price. Every search will increase 10 rupees perhaps, maybe 20 rupees. So these are all the competitive parameters they will be considering. So they will understand, that algorithm will understand highly this moment, this pin location having demand. Then how I can improve the business model in earning so much. If there is no demand, it will waive the fees, it will waive the charge. So similarly, if there is no demand also, it will take optimized decision to improve the business model. If there is huge demand is also, they will be increasing the payment or price of the particular business. So this is what they will do. The moment passengers start the journey, then OTP. This OTP helps them tracking the passenger and the car. Why they are tracking? Number one, recommending GPRS for all the route, the best shortest route or the traffic free route. Number one, that prime important of why they are taking OTP. The moment they take OTP, they will be tracking. Next, what they do is, with that, they will be understanding whether the mobile of either passenger or the driver is switched off. Either one is switched off, the decision making is different because of safety and security. If both of their mobiles are switched off, then decision making is different. By that time, they will take certain decision. They will be running some other programs, some other routines or IoT based applications to understand where exactly this car is positioned. What's going wrong with that? Why the passenger mobile is also switched off? Why the driver mobile is also switched off? After there are 2-3 victim cases happened across India, these are all the channelized system they have got. That OTP only guides for this kind of tracking progress and routing, and none of the cars should not stop more than 5 minutes. That is also tracked by this is a suspicious situation. None of the Ola and Uber cars should not stop more than 5 minutes in any of the location. Unless otherwise there is a traffic, they will not bother, because traffic is also through graphical data analysis, they will be understanding the traffic situation. If there is a traffic, there will not be any problem. The moment without traffic or nearby some shop or isolated place, if the car is there for 5 minutes, more than 5 minutes, immediately the decision making of this business model would be different. Yes, everything is fine. The moment the drop is happening, immediately they will ask to give you feedback. How much the customer is giving feedback, how much she is taking care, and how feedback is given for the driver. These are all the matter. The moment customer gives feedback for each and every ride, then that customer categorization is different. Because they will understand he is a regular customer, or they will be understanding this customer gives more value for our business, something like that. Then the moment driver gets a feedback, for him, they will be rating single star, 5 star, up to 5 star, they will be recognized in terms of ports or in terms of recognition or in terms of business generation, something like that. The feedback of the driver or that business owner is much more important for Uber for giving more business opportunities or for giving more business profit or for recognition, something like that. So these are all those things. Then once the drop is over for the customer, they will go for analysis. They will be classifying the customer, whether the customer is a regular traveler or frequent traveler or occasional traveler or a beginner. For the beginner also, they will give some exciting offers for sustaining or attracting that particular customer into their business model. So every category, the promotion code and the discount which they are giving, it would be different. So this goes on. Some of the scenarios I'm bringing out, but beyond that, what I am discussing, beyond that, they will be doing lot many more analytics. So every sphere, the moment we start giving the request to the travel, till we stops our journey, every moment the data is revolving around and guiding the entire business. So this is what I would like to share about, because every one of us starts traveling either by Uber and Ola, so that we may understand much more easily. So for the coding session, when it comes, I'll be giving very short coding session, duration of coding session today, but I'll be sharing all the commands and the notebooks files. And I request you to either work with a Spider or Jupyter Notebook or PyCharm or Google Colab or Kaggle Notebook. Kaggle Notebook and Google Colab, we no need to install at all. We can subscribe or we can go to Kaggle Notebook and we can start coding it. Then it will respond for all our execution. Similarly, Google Colab is a byproduct of Google. It is available with the Google Drive. You can search with the Google Drive. You can already, I hope so, in the WhatsApp group, our coordinators and organizing team started sharing manual and guidelines for this all. You can make use of any one of the mode. Now to start with data. Now we are data, the moment we say data, it has a lot of categories. Structured data, unstructured data, and it is said as image data, semi-structured data, and video data, audio data, or speech data. So the moment what data we are going to approach for our analytics, that makes the model to be different. Very fundamentally, the type of data determines what type of model we need to prefer and what we want to predict out of data. Although data seems to be same, and what we want to predict, these together decides the data model. What type of data and what we want to predict, both together decides our data model. In this 6 days of discussion, most of the time it is going to be addressed towards structured data. Structured data, again labeled data, unlabeled data. Within the structured data only, these two categories will place a role. They are labeled and unlabeled data. Most of the algorithm within the structured data, labeled and unlabeled data, we will be discussing. Data is often viewed as the lowest level of abstraction from which information and knowledge are derived. When we look at data, each and every attribute alone, never we cannot take decision. Or human can take decision with a single attribute, but machine cannot take any decision. It's a lowest level of abstraction. Culmination of several attributes or several columns together, several rows together, only a machine can learn. Data can be of structured data, can be of numbers, words, measurements, observation, or even just description of things. The moment English text or descriptions plays a role, again it is a machine learning, it is termed as natural language processing. Data is a representation of a fact, figure, and idea. Data on its own carries no meaning. If data to be an information, it must be interpreted and take on a meaning with the machine learning algorithms. Most of the time we are going to discuss in this workshop data as a table or CSV file or Excel file. Exploring data. The purpose of exploring data, or I can say this is the very first and vital stage of building a better model and deriving insights and taking business values. why we need to explore. We need to understand data to the core level using descriptive statistics and visualization. Together, it helps for exploring the data. The meaning called exploring the data is, for example, if you want to purchase a house in one particular location, near Secunderabad, if I want to purchase a house, I will be exploring a lot. I'll be exploring what is the pattern of the house, how that builder's capacity, and is that the building is good enough. I can assess that the quality of the building, and I understand what is the market value right now and what is the competitive price. So many things I'll be exploring. So once that exploration starts, we will gather a lot of information. We will learn something. Out of our learning, we will take some decision. Yes, I can purchase this 2BHK apartment, or I can purchase 2BHK individual house. That is called exploration. Even in our marriage ceremony, we will be exploring. The moment we fix the bride and groom, we will be exploring lot many about their traits, their character, their family background, their asset value, everything, their work experience or how they behave in the work environment. We will be keep on inquiring. Then we will be understanding, or we will be taking conversations. We will be meeting quite often for exploring the suitability of marrying that particular guy or that particular girl. So that is the thing happening with the data also. We need to explore. We need to understand a lot about the data before even choosing the model or before even building the model. That is called exploratory data analysis. We can do statistically, that is called descriptive data analytics, or we can do visual analytics. Both are helpful, or anyone, whichever is comfortable for the particular data analyst, they can use of either one or both. So these are all the way we can do exploratory data analytics. What it is all about, understanding what is a variable, every column of the moment that I say it, we all can visualize, it's a Excel data sheet. Then the moment I say Excel data sheets, it's a combination of several columns and rows, and every column has its own label. It will be said as serial number and designation and something like that. So many attributes will be there. Then what is all about? What is the data type of each and every column? The moment if I use 5.4 here, it is a float data type. The moment I use 5 here, integer data type. The moment I use 1, 2, 3, it is called ordinal data type. The moment I use A, B, C, grades, then it is called text data type or string data type. So what is a variable? Every column is termed as variable. Every column is a variable. Otherwise, it is termed as feature. Otherwise, it is termed as attributes or column, simply a column. All together, it is termed as variable, features and attributes. What information are we getting? What using these all, what we want to take decision or what we want to predict, what we are going to do with the data, that we need to understand. For every variable, we need to understand whether it is of string data type or numerical data type. Then variable type, again further, within that string data type, categorical data type, continuous or discrete. So this categorical, 1, A, B, C is categorical, 1, 2, 3 is a categorical. If I say designation, associate professor, professor, dean, HOD, principal, if I say something like that, it's called category string data type. Is the data is obtained from sample or population? This is also a vital for taking decision or building a model. Whether it is representing sample of that business scenario or population of that business scenario. So that is also important. Hope so these all the foundation you might be knowing. So types of variable, discrete variable, continuous variable. Underneath we can say nominal variable, ordinal variable. Discrete variable, otherwise nominal and ordinal. There are two more categories. That nominal variable always will give like color, nationality or state. We can say Telangana, Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, something like that. That is nominal. Name of something representing, that is nominal. Ordinal, whenever order, suppose rate this workshop, 1 to 10 is given. The value 1 given by the participant is different from the value 10 given by the participant. So that is called ordinal data. Continuous, it is a simple 5.4, these all continuous value. or integer also, even if I give 5, the numerical plays a role, it is odd continuous data. These are on the few terminologies we may need to be familiar before even getting into the model. What is model? Model is a mathematical representation of the real world process. Underneath, it will have most of the time statistics and probability, or matrix algebra, or linear algebra. These are all the four mathematical model. One is probability, another one is statistics. These are all the four mathematical models or phenomena would be playing role in most of the data analytical process. Then coming to algorithm, the moment we mix with our coding, Python or R or any kind of language starts using Java, anything we use, then it is termed as algorithm. Training, what is training? This part we may need to understand. Subsequently, we may need to understand what is testing. Given the data set, let me open one of the data set. Give me a minute. Yeah, I think you can see the Excel sheet right now. So meaning that this data, every column is termed as feature, attribute, something like that. Within the column, we may need to take decision how many columns we need to retain. That is feature selection, something like that. Slowly we will see one by one, but I wanted to emphasize here what is training and what is testing. In this particular data set, what we are trying to predict is price. This is test data. There is no price column available. If you look at the training data, 1 minute, I will take that also. Now the training data is taken. If you look at, there is a label, sales price. The last column which is shown here is a variable called sales price. It is called dependent variable. This variable dependent on all other variable in taking decision. For example, second hand house, resale house, the moment we start purchasing, what we look at, the quality of the house, built up area and total area, garage area, and what is the quality of the basement, so many things, and how many bedrooms available, and how many other living rooms available, and what is the nature of the kitchen, whether it is modern kitchen or it is a traditional kitchen, so many things we look at. These all the variables are said to be independent variable. Those all variable guides us in fixing the sales price. In our day-to-day life, human perspective itself, we can consider being a human, how do we share, how do we take decision among these all? The moment we purchase a car, if it is second hand or if it is first hand, whatever, we want to purchase a house or car, we will be considering lot many parameters. For example, built year, which year the house is built, and what is the quality of the basement quality. The every area has its own merit and its own disadvantage of the base. So if it is rock area, if it is soil area, if it is cultivation area, they need to check or they need to verify the basement quality. Then total built up area and how many floors and what is the total area. Garage area, the meaning of garage area is what is the free space available for utilizing. For example, children's play area, that is, we cannot own that children's play area, but we will be having, and there would be some space for accumulating all our building materials. So what is that kind of garage area availability? so many things we will look at. Nearby, all our needs, for example, school is yes or no type, yes available or no available. Nearby bus stand is available or transportation facility is available, yes or no. These are all the parameters we will be considering. If at all the person is a Hindu temple or the church or the mosque, whichever the availability they will be looking for. And is there any market or particular market or mall, something like that, or showrooms. So many things we will be looking into, and we will assess the overall quality, inviting one of the civil engineer or else any one of the expertise, and we will assess the quality, overall quality. We may rate overall quality as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 based on that rating. Now let us not think about machine learning. Let us think about how, being a human, we start taking decision. The moment if these all are given, immediately one of you will be asking, what is the location? The house which I am purchasing in the heart of the city is different from outskirts. The pin location or the area is a matter. However, the built-up area, if I start purchasing in the village side or outskirts or something different area, it would be different. Within the city itself, every pin location has its own demand or its own craze and famous and popularity. So pin location is a matter. The moment these all I am giving to you, any one of us very good enough to fixing the price of the house. These are all the parameters helping a human also to learn something about the house to be purchased. So these are all the parameters, each and every parameter helps. Somehow our brain mix, although it looks like so many parameters, our brain mix and matches. I don't know what is the model every brain has, but somehow human is capable of taking decision. The moment these are all the parameters or information I pass on, you can fix the rate. If at all, Secunderabad I am purchasing, it is going to become 1 crore. For the 1000 square feet 2BHK itself, definitely it will be fixed at the price 1 crore. Then you will be taking decision whether it is worth or not. This 1 crore is okay or not, you will be taking decision. How your brain is taking decision? All based on these parameters: built year, basement, built up area, floor, number of floors, total area, garage area, school availability, overall quality, pin location, when they have renovated, all together you will be considering and your brain would be taking decision. Similarly, in the computer, what we are going to do is we will pass 1000 records of all together, not only these parameters, the same parameters, including the price also we will supply. Minimum 1000 records or 500 records minimum required, at least 300 to 500 records required for training the machine. Whereas in the machine learning, machine is trained with mathematical model. Based on these parameters are said to be independent variable. Independent variable only guides for the dependent variable. Our dependent variable depends on this variable. 1 crore, how I am fixing the pin location is Secunderabad. So that I am fixing 1 crore. If it is outskirts of Hyderabad, if I say 1 crore for the same built up area, people will laugh at. So that pin location, overall quality, everything I need to consider to fix the price. This is called label data. I am supplying this label to the machine based on the traits of these all attribute. This 1000 has come. Then machine will learn with certain mathematical models or mathematical relationships. In learning the relationship between independent variable and dependent variable, it will start relating the relationship. Then what will happen is test. During the test time, we will not give this value. Price is not supplied during this test data. Price ought need to be predicted by the algorithm. Price is not supplied. I will give all the independent variable. Whatever are listed here will be supplied to the machine after training. This 1 crore is not supplied. based on this thousand records substituted during the training time, it will have some learning parameters or hyperparameters or learning parameters. Some certain amount of learning, certain pattern of learning will happen for the machine or the model. Based on that learning parameter, it will start predicting this value. The price is predicted. This is how OLX, all the business models or second-hand say car sale business or brokerage, online brokerage for selling the second-hand houses or even the new houses, they are fixing the price based on this automation. This automation for buying also, selling also, they will rely on the machine to be predicted. The based on the machine prediction, then they will go for a negotiation. Of course, although the machine is working, then human intervention is there, then negotiation. I may ask for 90 lakhs instead of 1 crore. Then if the builder feels to be profitable, then he will be coming for this. Or I may say, I will give 5 more references, but give me 80 lakhs. Then that seems to be very good enough for running their business. Then they may waive 20 lakhs for selling that particular house. Although the machine gives, subsequently human intervention will be there, but somehow it helps for automating and understanding quickly or taking decision making. Feature is what? Every column is a feature algorithm. And a few more things we didn't touch upon, that during the session, classification, regression and overfitting and underfitting, these are all the words or the terminologies we'll be coming across. Nothing to worry right now. Let us move forward. So most of the algorithm what we are going to be discussed in this workshop is with Python. So in order to honor the language builder, Guru wants Rosam, I wanted to show this picture. Python is released in 1991. With this introduction, we move on to the exploratory data analysis. What all about? I think all of us could be able to see data modeling stages on the screen. Yeah, then fine. Thank you. Consider. We can consider data either in the form of Excel or CSV. There is no much difference technically between Excel and the CSV. The file representation or formatting only different, internal formatting, but being a user, we would not notice any of the big changes. SQL data is also considered for analysis. JSON and BSON, this is the binary representation of key value pair, that is JavaScript object notation, XML data, text file. When the moment we use text file, separator like space, comma, tab, slash t, slash n, these are all the separators considered or treated, considered for treating the features and the columns. So any one of these data, the moment we start analyzing, it's termed as data analysis. It is offline data or online data or a streaming data, anything we can analyze, but the technique, the tools and softwares which we use for offline data analysis and stream real-time analysis would be different. For that, we may need to go for streaming softwares and the big data Hadoop setup or any other softwares we need to consider. The moment we read the data, any one of the data we can consider for our analytics, predominantly I'd be treating CSV file. Not even Excel in this workshop demonstration, but a variety of formats availability I'm just introducing. The very first step, what we're supposed to do, data pre-processing or data cleaning. It starts with handling missing values. Although the data comes from reliable source, it is the responsibility of the data analyst or the data scientist to ensure, is there any missing values? What is the proportion of missing value and how the distribution of the missing value, if based on that, lot many other techniques available, shortly we'll be discussing. But at the outset, it's a major title, handling missing value. What is a missing value? Empty cells, empty columns, empty rows, randomly data will be missing. Or else they will be putting NA, they may put NA also, null also. These all called missing values, NA, or space. Simply, it will be a space. There will be a lot of randomly missing values available. Data consistency check. What is the data consistency? Is really the data is suitable for the given problem statement. business business leader will be proposing business problem statement. Whether we got the relevant data relevant to the business proposed statement, that we need to ensure. Beyond that, consistency means all of a sudden you may see the price of the house would be going for lakhs together only. All of a sudden it will come into billions, 100 billion will come. Really you are running that business in the data, or it is induced as a wrong data, or something human error or typo error happened, or machine error happened, or automatically generated error will happen. Your business goes with every day only within 1 crore, but all of a sudden 1 billion figure is available. Is there any consistency? Do you really run the $1 billion business or only lakhs together business? Is the data is consistent? Really it is reliable? These are all the cross check we need to do across each and every row as well column. Both breadth and depth we may need to do for consistency check. Then next is dummy variable or encoding. What is dummy variable or encoding? Especially the very first model which is given in the syllabus is regression. Regression will work only on the numerical values. Anything which we give like red color, and I give like Tamil Nadu, something like that, if I give Delhi, if I give the label, or I give female, or if I give professor, these are on the label, it will not accept. It will not do any decision. It cannot even understand. It cannot even be substituted into the formula. All such labels or all such kind of string data type need to be converted into numerical. That process is called dummy variable introduction or encoding. How to be done? Let us see later. But somehow these are all the kind of data which are all playing a role within that columns or within that row, anywhere this kind of data may be revolving around, but that all need to be converted into machine readable format. That is called dummy variable or encoding. That is one hot encoding. So many other data methods available. Now major topics are introduced. We need to understand data consistency, we need to understand missing value availability, and how to treat. Again, it is little bit more we need to discuss about it. And data consistency, how to verify also we need to understand. And what are all the different techniques available for encoding and the dummy variable introduction, when we need to administer what kind of encoding technique, that also we need to understand. But it's an overview of discussion. Coming to exploratory data analysis, otherwise it is termed as graphical analysis, numerical analysis, depending upon the nature of the data. The moment we consider structured data or Excel data, the terminology exploratory data analysis is more than enough. So number one, descriptive data analytics. The moment we say descriptive data analysis, mean, median, mode, variability, standard deviation, variance, so many. I think by this time you will get some clue. These are all the parameters, many more available. Quite often, analysts will be using either one of these all. The moment we use these all, it will give output as a numerical value. But the analyst should be fit enough to interpret what that numerical value says about the data. What is the inference I can take out of that? The moment the data says mean is 5, what is the difference? The moment the data says mean is 50, what is the difference? The moment the mean says 500, what is the difference? This interpretation we may need to be in the position to take. Then normality check. Most of the statistical tools working on the philosophy called normalization. It's a kind of philosophy, or it's a kind of standard methodology kept for all the statistical formulas or statistical measures. All the measures highly reliable or working on normalization procedure. Normal distribution, you would have heard. If we consider any data, it takes the shape called bell shape. This is called bell curve, or it is said to be Gaussian distribution, or it is said to be normal distribution. The spread of the data resembles more or less bell shape. So this bell-shaped distribution, data needs to be in this distribution. There are several distributions available, Poisson distribution, so many distributions. Among that, statistical measure highly relies on normal distribution. We need to check each the normal distribution. It is possible to check only for numerical variable, not for other variable. So every numerical variable which is available or feature which is available in the data need to be subjected to this test. Statistically, it will be different. Kurtosis is one of the method we can use it for checking this normalization, or else we can use for explorative data analysis. We can just plot the data, more or less it resembles this bell curve. We can assume that it is following the normal distribution, then we can proceed with. So this normality check we need to do, correlation check with a hands-on also I'll be discussing, no need to worry. But before that, this terminology familiarity and the basic need of doing this and why we need to do, how we need to do, somehow we need to understand. When it comes practical, it's a kind of coding, nothing more that coding will explain us. After normality check, correlation check we need to do. Correlation check we may need to do between each and every independent variable and with the dependent variable. This correlation check is mandatory. That correlation says how much it can start explaining about the variable. Now, for example, in the house purchase, pin location explains a lot for understanding the value of the house. Especially the total area of that particular house is also a influential parameter. These two more than enough for me. If it is a new house, the total available area, total built up area and the pin location, enough for me to take decision to pay 1 crore or 2 crores. So that among so many variables, which is important, rather than if I look at there is no pink color painting, since I like pink color, if this house has only blue color paint, I will offer only 50 lakhs. I cannot argue like that. There are several variables predominantly explaining correlated with a dependent variable. Those variables will speak a lot, will help the algorithm to predict a lot. That kind of analysis we need to do. Now, being a human, I'm saying easily. The moment I purchase a house, the built-up area, the total area, pin location, these three only vital role player of fixing the price or paying the money for the builder. Rather than looking at the paint, how many plants are available, what is the interior decoration, that and all secondary, that all additional value. The prime cost of the house is fixed based on the total area, built-up area and the pin location. So this kind of imitation need to be happened with the data also. That how it can be done and fulfilled is with the support of correlation analysis only. Machine can learn and understand. Before even feeding to the machine, we need to understand which are all the variable gives very poor correlation, that are all need to be thrown out. It is not required to retire. So next, multicollinearity check. This is a little bit much more important than this correlation analysis. Let me explain what is multicollinearity check. For example, variable 1, variable 2, variable 3, variable 4, 5 and so on. I am having the real data also, by the time I will give one second. Every variable, this multicollinearity check, inflation varying parameter factor, inflation varying factor also we can use, IVF we can use, or else we can use simple correlation itself. What we use for correlation itself, we can use between independent variable, dependent variable. Let me say variable 1 is 0.9 related to the independent variable correlation value. Always correlation will be between 0 to 1. If towards 1, high correlation, towards 0, no correlation, towards minus 1, negative high correlation, then towards 0, whatever the number comes, these are all poor correlation, towards 0, this end also, these are all poor negative correlation. This is a poor positive, highly positive correlation, this is highly negative correlation, this is poor negative correlation. Similarly, 0.9 I'm getting. Variable 2 is also having 0.9. This is 0.2, 0.92, the next one is 0.91. Variable 3 is having 0.8, 0.6, 0.1. these are all the correlation four variable. Now we need to take decision. What decision? If we look at very poor correlation, variable 4 is having poor correlation. That signifies this variable cannot help anything for prediction or for the dependent variable. Nothing it speaks or nothing it conveys a meaning to the dependent variable. It is a useless variable that signifies I can throw away. 0.1 correlation cannot explain anything. What is the meaning is 10%. Even if I can say also 0.05, if I say much more you can understand. Only 5% it starts helping for the dependent variable in the learning or in the prediction. So it's ultimate, we can say it is a useless variable. So I can throw away. Then coming to this 0.6, it is considerably good. 60% of the explanation can be given by V4. To the prediction or to the model. Similarly, this variable gives 80% of the explanation. But here comes to the alert. We need to be alert here. What alert? Let us see. 90% of the time or 92% of the time, this variable helps for prediction. This helps 91% of the time for the prediction. It's well and good, very fabulous. But what will happen is, more than one person trying to explain the same amount of learning or same amount of explanation it is trying to give. That leads to different way of prediction. This is called multicollinearity. More than one trying to collapse. Now what will happen? I started consuming ginger tea at somebody's house. Then I started consuming elachi tea at somebody's house. I started consuming something, one more flavor I can say, clove tea I started consuming. When I started consuming, each tea was flavor is good and I was enjoying the delicious taste. Just because of enjoying all the three tastes, at my home I started preparing tea, mixing all three ingredients. What will happen? It may cause to vomiting also. All the three flavors place at a time in a roll, nobody will like. So all the flavor mixing together, it will lead to some other different flavor that may not be enjoyable also, that may not be predictable also here. It's a kind of analogy I'm trying to tell. It's like just because of good, we can't eat this all together. Similarly, here both of the variable is good enough, but both I should not retain. But if you have suspicious, what you can do is first retain variable 1, remove variable 2, build the model and observe the predicted value or prediction, the accuracy, whatever. Then remove variable 1, retain variable 2 and observe the perfection and accuracy or all other matrices. Or else retain both and do. This is another method. But we should be clever enough to understanding this kind of multicollinearity variables we need to detect. Then we need to approach with this process. Whichever gives the best accuracy, best, stability of the model, then you can retain, you can proceed further. There is no hard rule that need to be removed because we don't know which variable is suitable for our business, whether V1 is suitable for our business for giving better prediction or V2 is suitable for our business for giving better prediction, that we cannot assure. Because when we deal with the data, it is huge amount of data. It is not purchasing. We may purchase one house, but we may visit at the maximum 10 to 20 houses. We can't sit and visit 1 lakh house and take decision to purchase a house. But in this data analytics, the house prediction will have 5,000 records, 10,000 records. Among all those records, it needs to take decision. By the time, statistical measures and this kind of automation only will help. So we need to identify all the multicollinearity variables. Then we need to treat it. With why we are telling multicollinearity, 0.01% only difference between these two. So very close to each other. By that time, we need to treat one variable at a time, then all the variable at a time. If at all you have three variables, one more variable also you have near to this, then all other combinations we need to try. Three means some nine combination, retaining first, removing next to two, retaining second one, removing some, that all combinations we need to try. That is what the role of data scientist, because Python code does everything automation. Internet helps for copy pasting the code. But what else we do is this kind of exploration only we need to do. Next, removal or unwanted column. This is possible with correlation check also. This is possible with the common sense also. This is possible with exploratory other analysis also. Then we will be looking at one by one, but we need to consider removal of unwanted column, feature engineering. Feature engineering is something different. Whatever I am discussing, this portion, these are all called science. Science means I can teach easily because it is fixed. It's fixed in nature. Whatever I say, all other data trainer also will tell, scientist also will tell. Nobody will say differently. That is called science. The phenomena is thoroughly verified and tested. What is data feature engineering? It is art. Art cannot be taught. Cutting coconut, I cannot teach. Everyone need to practice cutting the coconut. So that is a kind of art. What is feature engineering? That while example we can say, for example, I will tell one case study. Suppose I want to buy a second-hand car. If at all second-hand car, for the customer you can't tell, telling month of usage. It is very tedious for them to calculate. There are people don't know basic mathematics also. So what you will be asking, how many years you used this car and how many months you used this car. Then that fellow easily will tell. I purchased in 1990 or 2000. So that 10 years I used, 5 months I used. Now, the same, only one attribute, usage we are trying to understand from that car seller. But we cannot ask him, go and calculate in terms of age, come and tell me the age. But it is very tough. It is very awkward situation to run the business. We rather we can create a columns in the sheet or in the website. Number of years after the purchase or utilization, number of months utilized, usage of the car. Something like that if you ask, that fellow would be giving very better. He may give 0 months also because exactly he would have used 10 years, then he is supposed to give 0 months. One more fellow will give 9 years and I used 3 months. One more fellow will give 2 years and 3 months, something like that. Now, for the machine, if you give these two as a parameter or a variable or a feature, whatever, it will be confused. None of the variable will be good enough or fit enough for explaining the usage. When it comes to car, usage is a matter in fixing the price. Although it is a Ferrari car, if it is used 10 years, how I will treat it would be different from if it is used only 2 years, almost the price of the car would be near to the new car. So this plays a predominant role in fixing the price of the car when it comes second-hand car sale. By the time, I need to convert it into age of the car. That means only in months, I need to convert years and months put together. I need to calculate what is the formula then 10 into 12 months, then plus months, 9 into 12 plus 3, 2 into 12 plus 3. This may be very simple for understanding, but feature engineering, when it comes to the real business case, we may need to be knowledgeable in the business domain. Only then it is possible to do business in means feature engineering very well. Here, not only art and science plays a role, then we should understand art of dealing with the parameters. Subsequently, we need to apply the formula or mathematics. Now, in this model, we apply the formula 10 into 12 plus months. Year value into 12 plus month value. Year value into 12 plus month value. First, we understood the art. Keeping these two parameters into two different columns, it leads to lot of underestimation or underprediction or underrepresentation. To overcome that, we are converting these two into a single feature that is called month. That month will increase the value of prediction. So in order to do this kind of feature engineering, it is mandatory for business domain. For example, in any kind of business data, one more example I just gave. Any kind of business data, if we consider, time stamp sometimes plays a role. Especially Uber and Ola, time stamp is a matter. That time stamp, if you look at, it is very clumsy. Date, time, and minute, second, something and all. It will give a lot of clumsiness in data, minutes. Computer generated timestamp you book at, either in the Ola bill, Uber bill or Amazon bill, that timestamp will be too much clumsy. If we pass this timestamp as such to the model, model prediction will be underestimated. We need to synthesize among the timestamp, hour is a matter, our date is a matter, our day is a matter, day, date, everything will be culminated together. So what I need to, minute is a matter, our second is a matter, what is matter for my business or for my prediction, that we may need to synthesize and we may need to take it out. This is one example when it comes timestamp data for the feature engineering. So we need to understand how we can integrate several columns into single representation, or how we can transform the given original data into different format or representation of the data for the prediction. All put together, it is termed as feature engineering. Coming to independent variable, dependent variable, we need to be very thorough on this for given the data. When it is labeled data, the moment we move on to unsupervised learning, there is no this concept called dependent and independent. Only for the supervised learning, we should be in the position to understand how many independent variables are available, what are all the data type of each variable, and how do we need to be transformed. That all we need to be very thorough on it. Anything maximum, we will have one single dependent variable. If we have multiple dependent variable also, we can treat it as separate dependent variable 1, dependent variable 2. Then we can build a model separately. No need to worry. We'll no need to consider both dependent variable at a time. One at a time we can deal. Same independent variable we can make use of in treating this dependent variable 1. Same independent variable set we can treat use of predicting or classifying independent variable 2. Dimensionality reduction. This is the curse of the data. Anybody looks into dimensionality reduction, they say it is curse of data. When we need to use dimensionality reduction? Only for features, not for rows. Rows, it is up to our decision. How many rows we can retain? Feature reduction, column reduction, in simple common layman terminology, it is number of columns reduction. This is called dimensionality reduction. We have LCA, linear determinant analysis, principal component analysis, again matrix algebra, linear algebra, norms, the determinant of matrix. These all only plays a role, nothing else. Eigenvalue, eigenvectors. When we consider this PCA, it's absolutely eigenvalue and eigenvector prediction. Nothing more plays a role in it. A row reduction, not at all considered as dimensionality reduction. I will discuss shortly after dimensionality reduction, how to reduce rows also. More than 2 lakhs records not required for predicting. Since it is available freely, we need to treat those much availability of data as such into the model. It may slow down the system. So not required for the prediction also. This is different category. Reduction of column only a matter, because every column is substituted into the formula. Every column has a highest parameter generated. Learning parameters are generated based on only the column, not based on rows. So in order to optimize or in order to reduce or speed up the processing or reduce the complexity of the model, we may need to do this dimensionality reduction. We will be seeing hands-on also, no need to worry. Now let us see row reduction. Row reduction being if across all the records or data set, if there is a consistency, what is the consistency? Every day Amazon is selling same kind of products, same amount of sale from each customer. Any customer comes to Amazon, purchases always 300 rupees to 30,000 rupees. There is no much big difference among all the customers. Let us say, for example, in Hyderabad region. Then there is a consistency. In this situation, just to throw certain records or delete records, because there is no more big change is happening in Hyderabad business with respect to Amazon. Any customer consistently they are purchasing 300 rupees to 30,000 rupees. None of the customer purchasing less than 300, none of the customer purchasing 30,000 and above, or yes, they are purchasing. Very lesser number of people are purchasing. That is called working range. We need to fix up working range. Then within, beyond that, below the 300 rupees and above the 30,000 rupees, records need to be deleted. Then all the records which we retain within the range is called working range. This 300 to 30,000 is called working range. Remaining all are need to be deleted. If there is a consistency, then by default, blindly we can throw away the records. So how much we need to retain is also a matter. No need to go for any kind of prediction with lakhs to the record. The maximum 25,000 record, 15,000 record, or 10,000 records, more than enough. Next, in the exploratory data analysis itself, we need to fix train test split. So that splitting need to be done during the exploratory analysis, or we can say before building the model. What is all about this? 1 minute.
Madam, can you give a 2 minute time for questions, please?
Yes, sir. Yes, okay. Sir.
Yeah, there's already one question posted on the chat window.
I'll look it up, sir. Please share your details, ma'am, to ask. Can we ask analysis using SPSS? Yes, SPSS we can do, sir. But what is the thing is, very limited number of columns and rows only we can subject to the SPSS. And number of models, whatever we could able to do with the Python and R, it is not possible. Restricted. There are very few algorithm. And also SPSS, we may need to have licensed version for the betterment of prediction or analysis. So maybe statisticians or for example research purpose we can use SPSS. For a real-time business model like Ola, Uber, Facebook, they cannot able to do. It's a kind of academic project also we can do with SPSS. For real-time analytics we need to rely on either standard tools for suitable for the data type, or Python code, R code, Java code, something like that. Yes, sir. I'm going on to the subsequent questions. Software defect prediction using ML in this regard, please share some inputs. Let us discuss after the workshop, Sharban Kumar sir, for this matter. Because based on the use case, what I have prepared and what it is stipulated in the brochure, we stick to that. Video recording will be given and the PPTs also will be shared, nothing to worry about it. Soon after the session, before 6 o'clock, you would be getting a recorded session also, PPT also. Sir, any other specific question, moderator, sir? Any other specific question?
Yeah, Jagan Mohan has this question. Can you please explain with an image as an example where we have multiple rows in columns?
Yeah, that is the moment I shift to image data, the way in which I build the model, the way in which I move the coding would be different. Whenever it is Excel data or this kind of structured data, it is different. Definitely, I would not be giving image data by this moment. Tips to select the model, that I will tell. Tips to select the model, I will explain. After exploratory analysis, we will spend much more time on selecting the model, definitely. Can you please explain the image? Yeah, image, definitely we need to, the moment we use image, it is termed as deep learning. Without a neural network, it is very tough or tedious to train the data. Neural network, the moment it brings to the picture, we are shifting from machine learning to the deep learning. Without neural network, whatever we do, those are all said to be machine learning. The moment we bring neural network, it is termed as deep learning in the common layman definition. Which is the best train test split? Yeah, for this question, that is what I am going to touch upon in the next few moments. Before that topic, train test split, we shifted or switching over to the QA session. Definitely, we will touch upon that. After 15 minutes, 12, yes, yeah, how to choose ML technique to apply for a particular problem. Not based on the problem, sir. ML technique need to be applied based on the availability of data as well as the problem. Both together, we may need to connect it and look at numerical data for ML and deep learning for images. Yeah, definitely. Exactly. Numerical data, not only numerical data, it's a kind of ordinal, discrete data and nominal data all together, the types we discussed, no? Categorical data and numerical data. Within that ordinal, nominal data, these all treated as ML. Deep learning, when it comes, even deep learning will work with the data which we analyze right now, the data which I shown, say, house price prediction, the same can be carried out with the deep learning. The data is also huge in nature, and the moment the neural network plays a role, that is the main emphasis on deep learning. Whereas machine learning, we may not use this. Feature engineering is only to reduce column, that is feature reduction or dimensionality reduction. Feature engineering is something much more better. We are making a strong parameter for the prediction, a strong explanating variable we are constructing or we are designing, we are creating out of the given data. That is called feature engineering. For example, again, I am revisiting once again. If I am purchasing a house at Secunderabad, outsiders may not be aware, Hyderabad, within Hyderabad, Secunderabad is one of the oldest and famous and very popular place for all the marketing and business and so many things, etc. So the moment I purchase a house in with that zone, Secunderabad, what I supposed to do? If I look at whether flower market is available or not, supermarket is available or not for fixing the price of the house, it will be very funniest way of talking. Rather, what I can talk, yes, already I know it is very popular location at Hyderabad. The moment I...
Madam, you are not audible.
Is it good? Yeah. Then the moment I'm purchasing a house in the Secunderabad location, if I talk about whether flower market is available nearby or not, something like that, a little bit internet connection is unstable. That is the reason. Always I need to look at how many bedrooms available, what is the quality of kitchen. Kitchen or built up area, total area, these and whether I am purchasing individual house, independent house or apartment. These are all the five major traits helps for fixing the price of the house. Whether I am buying also, whether I am selling also. That is called the feature engineering. These features, how to identify the possible powerful feature among the given set of features or transform. That is called feature area. That instead of what normally when we purchase house, no, we will look at synthesize each and every portion of our house. First floor, what is the built up area? Second floor, what is the built up area? And what is a car parking area? Something like that we will be looking at initially. When it comes to the machine, if you give like this, what is the meaning is first floor area and the ground floor built up area. And the third floor built up area, second floor built up area, something like second two floors I am having built up area. All three together, three separately, machine will not, or machine is underrepresented, or model is underrepresented. In this scenario, what is the feature engineering I need to do is, I need to convert all these kind of built up area into total built up area. Will get confused. We the human being, we may expect the second floor need to be smaller than first floor, or we may expect ground floor need to be smaller than second floor. That is our expectation. Based on that, our taste, we can fix the price. But machine, if we are trying to give all the three separately, it is underrepresented for the prediction. So that what we supposed to do in this scenario, I need to add first floor area, plus second floor area plus ground floor area. All the three I need to add together. I need to convert it into total built up area instead of keeping three. It doesn't mean that it is feature reduction. It is called feature engineering. We are transforming the availability of variable in the much more better representation for much more better explanation need to be given by all the independent variable for the prediction. For that, in the training data set, there is no dependent variable, no concept called dependent and independent variable. When we look at the data, definitely this kind of dilemmas will be eradicated. Nothing to worry. Just to have much more patience till a few more sessions to go forward. There is only one request for this question. Now let us move to train test split.
Madam, one more question is there. Just one more question.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Ma'am, good afternoon, ma'am.
Your session
is very nice and wonderful, ma'am.
Thank you.
I have a small doubt, ma'am. Actually, I am working on one project, ma'am, which is based on the agriculture farming data.
Okay.
So when I am working on that, ma'am, I'm facing little bit problems. Like I took the data, so I divided into training and testing data, ma'am.
Okay.
After that, when it comes to the data wrangling, I'm facing some problems and how to do. See, everywhere we are getting all these, ma'am, but how we can move and how we can solve it, there is no clarity, ma'am. If possible, in this session, you just take, no need to take any example.
Yeah.
Instead of the step, with one example, you're taking so many examples, it's it's very nice actually.
Yeah, I understand.
So one by one step, you are saying here normalizations and correlations, covariance. See, when we are going through all, we are getting a little bit confused why we should use and at which step we have to use all these things.
Okay, so I got it.
More,
definitely. One thing. Yeah, thank you. One thing I want to assure that hands-on session would be more because little bit delayed today's inaugural address altogether. That's why it's delaying. Okay. When the session goes, that clarity you will be getting more and more. Anyway, I'm sharing my official mail ID here to in the chat box to everyone. Please make a note. After a couple of days or after the end of the 6 days FDP, we can brainstorm with your data suitable to your need later on. So I can assure that whatever the steps I am going through in this slide, every steps suitable to the data I have collected, all the steps what I am articulating, I'll be applying on really on the data and I'll be doing coding. By the time you may be getting much more clarity. If not, also I can promise that I can associate with you in sorting out your issues. Make a note
thank
of my
you
mail.
Thank you so yeah. much, ma'am. Thanks a lot, ma'am. Thank you.
Let
so
us
much.
Go to this train split train test split data. Yeah, splitting the data, already there are a few questions that come in the chat box, but now only I'm going to start addressing this topic. First of all, we need to, it's a simple Excel sheet. I'll show the sheet for your imagination and for creativity. This is the data set. It has lot of columns and lot of rows. This much imagination is more than enough. Within that, if you look at the last column, which I have highlighted is said to be dependent variable or prediction variable, sales variable or Y variable. Technically, people will talk all the independent variable as X variable. They will say these are all rows as X variable. Column. This is the only column they used to call it as Y variable or predicting variable or predictive variable or independent variable. These are all the variable or exploratory variable. So many things they may call. That's it. This is what we are trying our machine to predict based on the past data history. See, for example, if I am coming across with a certain disease symptom in my family to somebody else, one more person also has that symptom. We will be recommending, we will be concretely telling this would be the experience through someone, we started learning, that out of that learning in near future, we can able to tell. Similarly, being a teacher, if we come across 10 to 20 students or 3 to 5 years of teaching experience, within the first test or within two contact class itself, we can able to take judgment on our students, whether that fellow will pass or not, whether that person would be capable enough to get a centum or not, something kind of prediction we can do. That is what we are making the machine also to do. Nothing more is a machine learning. We will observe certain things, certain phenomena, certain instances, we learn something, but I cannot assure how the brain is learning, that I don't know. But how machine is learning, we have mathematics. That part only we are discussing. Based on that learning, we start predicting the near future. For this learning, the entire data need to be splitted into four different items. This data only I am talking, both row and the column. This split is called train test split. Let us see how we need to do through the slide. So here, how we are going to split is, just now I said all the independent variables are set as x variable. All the dependent variables are set as dependent variable, only one. In my case, I am using only one dependent variable, that is sales price of the house. Why? So that now we understood which variable we are talking about. Suppose the number of records available with me, say for example 200 and 560 records, I am not sure. Let me take it as example. The Excel sheet which I have shown has 2560 records. This n records means, the moment I use the word records, I am talking about rows. This time train test split is connected with rows, not with columns. So far now, whatever we discussed, everything suitable only for columns. Till this point, till this stage, whatever I discussed is suitable only for column, nothing is for row. The moment we come to this train test split, it is suitable for rows. Among these rows, it has two different categories. Independent variables we have, many variable, or I can say n variables. Whereas dependent variable, I am having only one, that is sales price. Only one variable, that's all. So within this category, I need to divide 2560 record as test data, train data. Whenever we pull a data from Kaggle or GitHub, so you see a machine learning repository, they themselves will be splitting it into train data, test data. By the time there is no reason. In the test data, dependent variable will not be available. Train data, these all together will be available. But when it is not given, we are getting one data file. By that time, what we supposed to do is, we need to delete dependent variable for the test data. Train data we need to retain. Now, what is X train? Among 2560 record, I can split in this proportion. Let us come to that proportion a little bit later. I need to split these records into two different categories. One is train data, one is test data. Now, if I split the same category into two different, train and test, TR I am putting, TE I am putting. Independent variable, I am converting, I am pulling some of the record into training data, some of the record into testing data, that is called X train and X test. Then among this dependent variable, I am splitting it into two different categories, training data and test data. I am pulling some of the records into training data, some of the records into testing data. That is called Y train and X train, X test. What is that sum of the records? That is a proportion, 70-30 rule, 75-25 rule, 80-20 rule, 90-10 rule. 70-75 rule when we can use, when the records are more with you, I can say I am having good number of records with me. 2560 record is very good amount of record I am having. So that either I can use, there is no big difference between 70-30, 75-25. So I don't want to talk about it. But 80-20, then the records are lesser. Suppose for example, we can consider 1000 records. Then we may need to use 80-20 rule. If I am having, I have one more data set for the classification, breast cancer data analysis, so predicting whether it is malignant or not. The total record availability itself, 560 records, total record itself. Then I cannot go for 70-30 rule. I need to use 90-10 rule. That's it. This rule split is the proportion of splitting. First we started discussing how to divide. Now, somehow I'm dividing this into two different categories. What is a proportion training data, testing data is the question. For by the time, if your records are larger in size, 1,000 records and above, like me, I'm having now 2,500 plus records. If we have, we can bold enough to choose either 70-30, 75-25. What is the meaning this? For example, in the class, teacher alone kept on teaching 100%. Then how do you understand students are learning or not? We recommend self-learning activity, presentation, learning activity. By the time we will ask our students to give a seminar on last one unit or a few topics of last unit. By the time we can able to understand how much they have learned, or sometimes we may not teach couple of topics also. But we would be conducting a test on those topics. We will be accelerating self-learning. So that shows that the quality of learning. That is why 70% training means what? The teacher is teaching 70%. Student is test on 30%. If the 30% prediction is good, the accuracy is good, your model is good. How to choose a model? When the days are going forward, definitely every one of us can understand how to choose the model. Now it is not the right time to explain that. Let us hold for some more time, then I will address for that question. Perhaps you may be a thorough one, or you may be understanding the concept called train test split. The entire Excel sheet need to be divided into four variables. The proportion of variable is 70. Y train, Y test and the X train, X test need to be split on the same proportion. Proportion we cannot change. It won't allow you to do also. Python will do everything for you. One line code, it does this all. But we may need to understand what's happening inside. Then data modeling. We can do the model with the concept of differential calculus, linear algebra, matrix algebra, probability and statistics. Every model, the mathematical phenomenon will be different. That is why we are calling it as different models. Coding, how we can do, we can use SAS code, Python code, R code, Java code. Model validation, yes, not only model building is a great achievement. We need to validate how far our model is reliable, good enough. For that, lot of model validation matrices we need to come across. Yes, I have verified model matrices, validation matrices also. After verifying matrices, validation matrices, I found that it is not producing good accuracy or something wrong. Right now the terminology not required. I'm giving overview. Something wrong. Now what I can do? Or I'm not satisfied with that measures. What I can do is we can go for model tuning. We are not changing the model. We are trying to improve the same model. It is called model tuning. Same model will be working on. One student is not studying well, just because of that I cannot leave that roll number, I can concentrate on other roll number. I can tune him, giving different materials, different way of teaching, different way of approaching him, different way of encouraging, motivation, something like that. It is called model tuning. We come to know the model is not performing well, not up to the mark. Not performing well is not up to our expectation or not up to the benchmark. Then what is supposed to do is we can go for model tuning method. After applying model tuning method, we may need to go for revalidation. What is that matrices? This matter is different from every model. At least it is different for regression and it is different for classification. At least broader sense I'm taking. Telling. Beyond that also, regression has several models. Each model within regression will have different matrices. Similarly, classification, if we consider 90%, it has same matrices. That's it. Now coming to classification and what is regression, every day that is the title we are going to discuss, definitely we can able to understand. I wanted to give you one tip. 80% of the time, industry uses 80% of the time, industry uses classification model. 20% of the time only, industry uses regression. It doesn't mean that regression is not important. The proportion of usage in the industrial scenario, I'm just giving you quote based on Gartner report or the benchmark of industries. That's all. almost we reached 1251. Maybe organizers or what to say, that the coordinators would be sharing the feedback form. I kindly request you to fill up the feedback form, and we will be dealing with whatever the overview we have discussed. We will be dealing with all the other concepts. Maybe today we didn't announce you that that delay occurred for half an hour. I will be addressing subsequently after two classification models, and the fourth day I'll be revisiting back. By the time I may extend half an hour more also. 10 o'clock if we start, I may extend up to 1:30 to fill that bridge, whatever we missed out. With that, I would be signing off with you all. And tomorrow we will be having different resource person and the classification model, and day after tomorrow also classification model. Subsequently, hands-on exploratory analysis and regression model we will be discussing on fourth day. Each day the same Zoom link we supposed to use, and each day 10 o'clock the session starts and stops by 1 o'clock. Maybe every day 10 minutes short break would be available, and the Q&A session would go at the end. Maybe another 5-10 minutes I can go with the Q&A session, then we can close the session.
Will you share the link?
Yeah. All of you requested to share your name, email address, college or organization, name, department. These four credentials we request you to share in the chat box, and feedback form for the today's session and MCQ questions based on today's coverage. 10 MCQs are given. Nothing to worry, it is a bit easier for your participation. You can take part in those two, maybe another 45 minutes up to 2 o'clock they may keep it open, I think so. 1:30 to 2 o'clock they may keep it open. So both two Google form links are shared here. One is sending with R6, same all in one feedback and all in one feedback and 10 MCQs all in one. There are four times the same link is shared. You can make use of any one of the link and take part in for another 10-15 minutes. Meanwhile, I'm ready to address for MCQs. Anyone, if you have, so far now what we have covered, if you have any doubts. Given the data, we should be in the position to understand, based on the problem statement, whether we are going for prediction or we are going for classification or we are going for clustering. That three words, that is a major understanding or major prediction or major decision making we should do. Whether based on data, this decision is to be taken based on data and problem statement. This is the first guideline. Once if we know what we are going to do with the data, that is called problem statement. What we are going to do is called problem statement. Then we need to come to the conclusion whether we are going to do regression or classification or clustering. Definitely it is not reinforcement. So these are all the three algorithms we need to. Yeah, feedback link is posted, sir. Please scroll and look at Jairam, sir. Please scroll. There are four times our team has posted the feedback link as well as assessment link. Please look into, scroll few message up. Yeah, once again, it is posted. Now clustering, when to use regression, the variable which we are going to predict or the theme what we are going to predict is of numerical in nature, then it is regression. What we are going to predict is of categorical in nature, decision making. Categorical in nature, then it is classification. What is clustering? Grouping based on certain attributes or traits. It's called clustering. Then coming to the picture, regression. Is there one model or multi-model? Many models. What is our duty is, we come to know regression is a suitable model or suitable method for our problem statement and data. We need to try out each and every model until we feel satisfied result or that validation matrices are satisfied. Similarly, classification. If you are lucky, the first model itself, you will get better accuracy or better matrices. classification also, we have many models, several models. We need to try all the models. Even if you do a research publication for the given data set and the problem statement, at least 2 to 3 models we may need to write and compare the outcomes or inferences. Clustering also has many models we need to try. First, we need to fix with the data and the problem statement whether we want to do regression, classification or clustering. Subsequently, we need to try one model other one by one. Within the same model itself, we can have the concept called tuning, model tuning. Every model has tuning. We can try first one model, we can tune that particular model, then we can move to the other model until we feel satisfied result with the several models, we can keep proceeding. That is the role of data analyst. When it comes coding, there is no work. It's after all often our job for any model to be built and seen the results and validate the matrices. But insights and the philosophy behind of every model and understanding clarity and concrete storytelling power we should have. Data science, additionally, people are expecting art of storytelling. That what is the meaning of storytelling is we must be in the position to justify why we have chosen this model, what is the result we have obtained, each result, how it inference or how it adds a business value, what that signifies, that all those things we may need to put it in the business language. Name it Telugu or it is Kannada or it is Hindi or it is English, but we should be in the position to articulate in human language. That is called data storytelling. So that level we may need to reach. For that, the intricacies of every model, how the working principle of model, how it works, that all we may need to understand. For that only this theory session goes on. When it comes practical session, it's after all half an hour or it's after all maximum 1 hour, we can cover whatever we discussed today. With that, I think I may sign off with you all from the QA session. Before 6 o'clock, I can assure that the PPT recording session as well as Python material stuff to be done in the subsequent class also, and the missed out session of today also. I thought of doing half an hour hands-on session at the end, but that is missed out. So altogether, I will be sending you, nothing to worry. Thank you all. Wish you all success.
Thank you.